2021 is going to be an exciting year for human spaceflight and space exploration. So let's have an overview of all the interesting things that are going to happen in this year. From SpaceX's Starship, to NASA's Artemis program, to robotic exploration of Mars, and so much more.
And at SpaceX's Boca Chica facility meanwhile, Starship SN9 is indeed already preparing for a high-altitude test flight, the second one ever with a Starship prototype. And the SLS core stage of Artemis 1 is being prepared for the final green run test, namely actually firing up the engines. A lot is happening in spaceflight, so stay tuned. So now that 2020 is finally over, the young year 2021 wants to prove that it can even surpass 2020. However, luckily in spaceflight matters, 2021 is going to surpass 2020, but in a positive way. But let's first start with current developments. At SpaceX's facility in Boca Chica, South Texas, the big event was the successful static fire test of the SN9 prototype. On the 6th of January, the three Raptor engines fired up for a static fire test. While the test looked good, it turns out that this static fire test was noticeably shorter than the previous ones, for example with SN8. Lab Padre made an excellent video comparing the three SN8 static fire tests with the SN9 static fire test from January the 6th. So why was the SN9 static fire, with only 1.5 to 2 seconds of duration, cut so short? Well, it could have been a post-ignition abort, or it could have been shortened intentionally in order to avoid damaging the launch pad's concrete surface, as Chris B. from NASA Spaceflight speculated in this tweet here. Whatever the cause, the next static fire test with SN9 is already scheduled, and there's a very good chance that it has already occurred by the time we release this video here on January 9th. If so, then you can see some awesome static fire footage right now. And if not, then we are sure it is going to happen anytime now. Either way, another successful static fire is a prerequisite for the upcoming SN9 test flight. In the latest NOTAM, the flight date currently being targeted is January 10th from 1400 UTC until 2359 UTC. With SN8, we faced quite a few delays, but we are optimistic that the SN9 flight won't see so many delays. And the flight itself will be an exact copy of the SN8 flight, but hopefully this time with a landing that doesn't end in a fireball.
And 2021 will of course be an even more exciting year at Boca Chica than 2020. So what can you expect in 2021? Well, first, many more Starship flight tests, of course. Maybe even test flights in tandem, as this interesting exchange between RGV aerial photography and Elon hinted at. But of course, the first Super Heavy prototypes will be assembled in 2021, with a testing campaign for the booster prototypes, similar to how we saw them for the Starship prototypes. And then with any luck, we might see a first orbital launch attempt in late 2021, complete with Super Heavy and Starship. At NASA meanwhile, preparations are ongoing to complete the tests of the SLS core stage, which is the very same core stage to be used for the Artemis 1 mission. This will be the unmanned test flight of the complete SLS system together with the Orion spacecraft on a round-trip flight around the Moon, currently scheduled for November 2021. But you know how it is with dates regarding SLS. Let's formulate it like this. Compared to the SLS time, Elon time seems to be an ultra-precise and perfect estimate for future events. On December 20th, a wet-dress rehearsal test of SLS was conducted, where the core stage was fully loaded up with liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen propellant. This was the first time that the propellant tanks were filled with cryogenic fluids. Engineers detected no leaks during the multi-hour test, but the simulated countdown was automatically stopped with 4 minutes left until the planned hold point. NASA said in a later statement that the countdown was halted due to timing on a valve closure. Julie Bessler, SLS Stages Manager at Marshall Space Flight Center, said, During our Vectress rehearsal green run test, the core stage, the stage controller, and the green run software all performed flawlessly, and there were no leaks when the tanks were fully loaded and replenished for approximately 2 hours. Data from all the tests to date has given us the confidence to proceed with the hot fire. So the green run hot fire test, where the rocket will be fully loaded and all engines will be fired up for a longer duration, complete with every step as in the real liftoff procedure, can start and is currently scheduled for mid-January.
And please subscribe to our channel if you want the latest news on spaceflight in a non-whitewashed way. Oh, and you can also find our videos over on Odyssey. Odyssey is a new video site that was created to recapture some of the freedom and independence of the old internet days away from the corporate favoring ways of YouTube. It's based on the decentralized blockchain technology, so no single entity can control the publication of videos, as in the case of YouTube. Just click the link in the video description to follow us over on Odyssey. Talking of SLS and the Artemis program, some other cool stuff is going to happen in 2021. Of course, Artemis 1, which we mentioned before, but regarding the human landing system, NASA will make a choice in March this year which contender or contenders will continue to work together with NASA in building the next moon lander that will actually land astronauts on the surface of the moon. So the Apollo Lunar Module 2.0, if you will. Currently we have Dynetics, which have in our opinion an excellent moon lander called ALPACA. Not only is it almost one stage, except for the fuel tanks which are shed during the landing procedure, then it is really spacious, almost like a habitat module, and it is also modular in design, thus allowing it to be transformed into a pressurized rover or to build a small moon base with a few such modules. And it is really low-lying so that astronauts can exit and enter the module very easily. The next one we like to call the Lobby Lander because it's from the national team, consisting of the old school aerospace players like Lockheed and Northrop, but with the new entrant Blue Origin, who decided that lobbying is better than innovation, so they chose to side with these companies. This lander is our least favorite as it is very complicated with a three-stage design, has a smaller habitat volume, and a gigantic ladder that doesn't look really safe to us. And the last one is of course the lunar version of SpaceX's Starship, which is, together with the Dynetics ALPACA, our favorite. It has the largest interior living volume by far, and also by far the largest payload capability. Let's hope that NASA will choose the human landing system wisely and not poorly.
He chose poorly.
NASA might not be so efficient anymore regarding human spaceflight as compared to the Apollo era, but regarding robotic exploration of the solar system, they are still king. And lots of robotic explorers will arrive at Mars this year. First, the UAE's Mars Hope orbiter will arrive at Mars on February 9th. The orbiter is going to study the planet's atmosphere in order to better understand Martian climate and weather phenomena. Then later in February, the Chinese probe Tianwen-1 is also expected to arrive. It will orbit the planet for a few months, until the lander will descend to the Utopia Planitia region. The Chinese lander also sports a rover. So if successful, China will be the second nation after the US to manage to land a rover on Mars. And talking of rovers, NASA's Perseverance rover is also scheduled to arrive at Mars on February 18th. So February will be an excellent month for Mars exploration. We talked about the Perseverance rover already a few times on this channel. It's very similar in size, weight, and architecture to the Curiosity rover, but it has some additional science instruments, allowing it to better scan for signs of life, and carries a small flying drone with it. This will be the first time ever that flight will be performed on another planet. So Mars-wise, 2021 will be an incredibly interesting year.
And then on October 31st, the James Webb Space Telescope will finally launch on an Ariane 5 rocket. This is the successor to the Hubble Space Telescope and with its 6.5 meter diameter mirror, will have over 7 times the light capture capacity than Hubble with its 2.5 meter diameter mirror. Its spectrometer will be sensitive enough to detect gases in exoplanet atmospheres, planets in other star systems many light years away from us, possibly even allowing us to detect biosignature gases, which can only exist due to the presence of life, or with luck even technosignature gases, which can only be created artificially through processes involving technology. So 2021 will also be an exciting year for astronomy and astrobiology.
Then, having just mentioned Ariane 5, the Europeans very well know that if they want to play any role in the future, they will also have to go fully reusable. To that end, 2021 will see efforts for ESA's Themis project. That is how their first reusable rocket will be named. We already have a few renderings of the Themis rocket, and the engine, codenamed Prometheus, is already under development. So 2021 will see ongoing efforts towards reusability, and not only in Europe, but also in Russia at Roscosmos with their armor project. And of course in China, with the companies iSpace and LinkSpace being most far ahead regarding reusability. And we must go reusable, not only to drive down costs for spaceflight, but also to solve the space debris problem. With full reusability, no new space debris will hopefully be created one day. Thus, the number of debris objects in space will also start declining again.
Regarding China, in 2021, we will see the first module of their space station being launched on a Long March 5B rocket sometime in the first half of 2021. This main module, named Tianhe, will be the main habitat module of the station. Two experiment modules will follow in 2022. Then we'll also see two more flights with astronauts to the ISS on SpaceX's Crew Dragon this year, while Boeing's Starliner will try to fly their Starliner without crew in late 2021. Let's see how that will go. Well, maybe they will have managed to have fewer bugs this time.
Oh, and the commercial lunar era begins in 2021. Intuitive Machines, for example, plans to fly their Nova C lander to the moon on a Falcon 9 rocket, slated to launch around October this year. It will deliver 6 NASA and 6 commercial scientific payloads to the Oceanus Procellarum region of the moon. And India will also launch their Chandrayaan 3 mission later this year, in order to make up for the lost Vikram lander of the Chandrayaan 2 mission. Thus, Chandrayaan 3 will only consist of a lander, and we really hope to see them succeed this time.
And if you think commercial payloads to the moon are nice, but you would prefer to have a moon base, then we have a video where we talked about the Chinese plans to build a moon base. You can watch it right here.
So thanks for watching the JAI Space Report, and I would say, on to the future!
Okay.
2021 will be an incredibly. Did I say 2020 or 2021?
2021.
Really?